right? And you have, you've had a meal in the RT canteen, and I think Don Run was on the menu today, which not only describes the contents, but the effects. Anyway, listen, nice to see all of you looking so well. Where is Anna O'Toole? Unshaw, she said.
Unshaw,
right.
Yeah.
Anna, what is your part in all of this?
Well, I was doing a postgraduate course in Maynooth College on adult and community education, and in conjunction with the adult education organiser for County Offaly, Maria Drin, who's sitting behind me, we set up the Golden Years Club in Edenderry as part of adult education.
Very good. Have you got a permanent drop-in centre or anything like that?
We have. We were very lucky. Our local librarian was very good to us, Anne Coughlin and Noel Whelan, and they gave us the use of a lovely, comfortable room in the library once a week.
Excellent.
Yeah.
And what sort of things do you get up to?
In the first 8 weeks, initially, all the club members had lunch, which was provided by the pre-employment class in the secondary school.
You're for eating. You ate your way through our canteen. There's not a scrap left over there. It's some sort of eating club.
And then that was funded by the local Lions Club.
Mm-hmm.
And that was for the first 8 weeks, but now we don't have that. So they meet from 2 to 5 every day, every Thursday. And they have crafts and a cup of tea. And
now, I know, as you mentioned crafts, you're planning a sale of work.
We are, yes.
A little fundraiser.
Yeah, for Christmas.
For Christmas.
Yeah.
And you brought in a sample of some of the work that your members do.
Yeah.
And if we can have a look, can we have a look over at the craft table over there? Because there's some nice interesting bits and pieces, which remind us, in fact, I think, of some of the craft items we've done on this show. That is collage. It's a hunting scene. And it's little bits of cloth stuck together to make a very pretty picture. And then just beside that, moving across, you can just see the beginning of the water there. The tail of the swan, there it is, not a hint of diesel oil about it. The beautiful swan, again, I think that is collage, or is that embroidery? Will somebody wise me up? Is that embroidered or is it collage? It's Mrs. Patterson. Well, that covers that, right. Okay, and then beside the swan, oh yes, now there's a more conventional, nice two-tone green jumper with a button collar there. Nice item there. And if you're dressing up to go out, and you want something a little bit flashier, there's a lovely silvery finished shawl there. Lovely bit of work, that. And that's, I presume, is crochet work, that.
Yes.
Fine,
yeah.
Thelma would know about those things. Mm. Lovely piece of crochet work. And then moving across, I think, by golly, what have we got here? A huge furry beastie of a thing. It is a lion, no less.
Yeah.
A lion. I'll come back to that in a wee minute. Moving on past the lion, beside the lion's tail, and up a little bit. Ah, would you look at that? Isn't that as cute as can be? Look. A little pair of booties and a wee jumper there for a toddler. Very nice indeed. Congratulations. Mm. Out of curiosity, tell me something. What about the lion? Who did the lion?
It was done jointly by the club, for the Lions Club in Edenderry, who have been very helpful to us.
Of course, all our
started,
own pals in the Lions Club.
Yeah.
Lions Club, in fact, are very, very good with us because they help us run. They do most of the work, to be quite candid, in the over 55s talent competition. You should have your entries in for that by now. But if there's somebody singularly talented who, for some reason or other, is not aware of the fact that we're running in the competition, just tell your local Lions clubs, I said it was all right, okay? And you can drop us a line right away, get the entries in, because they're really meant to be closed. However, and that applies to me. A little reminder, you know the first prize in our talent competition is £2,000. That's not bad, is it?
No.
Promoters of Inversoft Paper Products put up £2,800 in all. And we've got 4 holidays to give away, Saga holidays, holidays in the sun and so on. So that's a good one. So get on to that. If you haven't done anything about it, get on to it now. Mm. Any talent in your crowd?
Yeah, we have one fantastic singer, Nancy, here.
Nancy?
She's a very good singer, yeah.
Well, we'll maybe have a chat with Nancy afterwards.
Yeah.
I'm interested in thinking, well, one of the nice things about your club is there's lots of men in it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Obviously, Edenderry hasn't got the mortality rate that the rest of the country is. Normally, this is like a mass. There are about 4 men up the back, and the rest is widows looking for men.
Yeah.
And the rest of the audience. Where's Tom Lynch? That's Tom there at the end. You're very welcome, Tom.
Thanks a lot.
Your father was fighting in the 1916.
Yeah, he was working in Dublin at that time, clerk for the Dublin Corporation. And he was involved with the 1916 rising. And he was told to get out of the city in quick notice because he'd be court-martialed the next day.
And probably
and he went down to the
wall.
Country, yes. Mm. And he went down, of course, with a lot of the boys on the run down there at the time. And a lot of them had a dugout out 3 miles away in the fields. And there was a house on the top of a hill it was always in their view, you see, they'd be lying up all day and they'd be out cutting trees at night and cutting bridges and things like that. So,
would this be the block, this would be the block roads?
Yes, the block roads, and they'd be lying up all day and they'd be fed there by local people who knew them, but they had a house in the hill and there was a woman living in the house.
This was outside Eden Derry?
No, yes, well, there's a good bit outside Eden Derry now. And the IRA boys could see the house, and when there was any danger about, there'd always be a red garment hanging on the line. You see?
I don't like to ask which particular garment.
It could be a shift, it could be a piece of anything.
I suppose, depending on the garment, it could mean send us some more support.
No. There's a warning that they weren't to store out.
Right.
So when there was a white sheet running on the line, there'd be always on the go around, you know, in the daytime. So they'd be helping people that helped them. But the wind out of it was, this day, the red garment appeared on the line in the morning time. Rement there all day, all overnight, and was there the next day around 3 o'clock. And the boys were starving in the dugout and they couldn't get out to get a bit to eat. So the wind out of it was one of them, a volunteer, to go over and have a look at them in through the window or up near the house, see what was the cause of it. A man stole up to the window and he looks in, here was your woman and she in bed with the fella, and they were there in the
Well, I think I have a very good idea now what the garment was that was hanging on the lines, as you put it that way. Right. Yeah. Your father, in fact, worked as a rent collector in Dublin
Corporation. Yes.
And the whole family moved when he went on the run.
The whole family moved, yes.
The whole family moved down. So you were effectively raised in the Eden Derry area?
I was raised in the County Meath.
Oh, in the County Meath?
Yes.
Oh, you're just a blow-in then.
Well, Dublin is... I'm a Dunman by birth.
Sure.
But Meath was the County Meath adoption, and so is Offaly. I'm living in Offaly now.
And what did you take up as your own career?
Well, I worked with farmers.
Well, you weren't a tax collector anyway.
No, thanks be to God, no. No.
And what sort of things did you do?
Well, when I was a young lad, I worked as a crow starver. You ever hear anything about that?
A crow starver? Come on, what?
Well, you put a bit of a rope around your neck like that, and you got two bin lids, and you clap them in a field, and you're breaking crows out of the car.
That was your career?
No. It was only a beginning. It was only a beginning.
I'm told that you're a fairly handy fisherman.
Well, I fish a lot, and I think that the best fishing of all is dry fly fishing for trout.
I agree with you. I think it's terrific.
And the upright split wing floater, there's the lure par excellence and a good outfit.
Yeah, do you realise there's only two of us in this studio know what you're talking about?
I said that.
At the moment. I lost you on the bin lids, but I found you again on the... How long are you retired?
I'm retired 7 years.
Were you married?
I'm married, yes. Married for 42 years.
That proprietary nod you gave to the lady in the front row means that you don't have any wee signals to tell him that it's not safe to come home or anything.
there is. I went up to town one evening and I bought a pair of boots.
Yeah.
And I got drunk coming home. Before I came home.
I won't tell anybody. Go on.
And I came home along and there was a... I thought I was at home, you see, and I saw this telegram pole and a light at it and I put the K into the telegram pole, and here a guard comes down the road. They were riding bicycles at that time. And he says, there's no one at home there, mate. You're wrong, says I, there's a light upstairs. So he got a hold of me, brought me home, put me into the missus, and see if a night home, so he has a few jars. So I went in and sat down with the fire, and the room was fairly warm, you see. And the room was fairly warm, and it's you had to see two things, and I looked over and I saw two women, and the two of them were the same. I said, surely to God to say, I'm not married twice. So the woman says to me, you're up and get me a bucket of water up there at the phone. She's waking you up. Up to the phone, I got a bucket of water, brought it back down, and she threw it on top of me at the door. That just tore me up a bit. So the next thing, I went up to the fountain and I got another bucket and I come back and I threw it on top of her and said, that's waking you up to a bit. So out of that, we met it up in bed. That's how that happened.
Well, there's an interesting little piece of marriage guidance there from Eden Derry. Why don't you just toss a bucket of water over each other? Listen, I know that you're great. I know that there's, as I say, you've got one great singer with you. I know you're fond of an old song. And no better person in this programme, let me tell you, to render a song than our own Anne O'Dwyer.
Oh, Once in the dear dead days beyond recall, when on the world the mist began to fall, out of the dreams that glow in happy throng, lo, to our heart love sang an old sweet song. And in the dusk, where fell the firelight gleam, gently it wove itself into our dream. Just a song at twilight, when the lights are low, and the flickering shadows softly come and go. Though the heart be weary, sad the day and long, then to us at twilight comes love's own song, comes love's own sweet song. Just a song at twilight, when the lights are low and the flickering shadows softly come and go. Though the heart be weary, sad the day and long, then to us at twilight comes love's old song, comes
absolutely lovely indeed. Thank you, Anne O'Dwyer and Aoife Flynn. Just before we get on to our next item, I just wanted to refer back to last Monday when, in fact, we were talking about nursing homes. And I got a letter during the week from Reverend Robert E. Lee, the chaplain in Merlin Park Hospital in Galway. And he says that they've got 400 patients down there, 120 of them are older people, and that they love the show, never miss it, and they sent their regards to us, and indeed, I'd love to send our regards back to them and keep on watching. Well, now I'd like to introduce you to Nolo Sullivan, the Head of Information with the National Social Service Board.
The information that you would put on would be correct.
Lovely, Nolo. Thank you very much indeed for joining us today. Now, Derek.
Yes, let's have the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth. Aggie Ryan, where are you? Aggie Ryan, down at the front there. Born in Edenderry?
Edenderry, yes.
Lived there all your life?
Edenderry, yes. I've married in Edenderry.
My golly. You're well dug into Edenderry.
Yes.
All right. Do you have children?
Well, two in England. Two one 41 years of age and the other 29.
Well, at least you've got an excuse for getting out of Edenderry from time to time. All right. What did you, I mean, obviously, if you're born, raised and all the rest of it there, did you start working in that area?
I did, yes.
What did you work at?
In the Edenderry Shoe Factory.
Oh, the famous factory.
Yes.
Famous
it was
factory.
The only place, really, of employment at that time, you know.
And what did you do?
And I used to put the insoles in the shoes and stamp the soles of them made in Erin.
That was it?
That was it.
In went the
but
insoles and all went
to 1,300 a day.
How many?
1,300 a
1,300
day.
1,300 of them? All with the insoles.
All fashion shoes.
And each one, that's two insoles, if you know what I mean.
Yeah,
I mean yes,
yes,
yes.
Yeah.
That kept you out of mischief. How long were you at that?
I was 8.5 years there before I was married.
Ah, and he took you away from
he
all of that.
Took me out of it then, yeah.
I know your husband has passed away. How long were you married?
I was married, it was our Ruby anniversary just a few days before he died.
And what's Ruby now?
40 years.
40 years.
Yes.
Well, that was a good long time
it
together
was
now.
Indeed, yes.
Great time together. And what do you do now? I know you were in at the founding of this club.
Yes, and I'm involved in the club and I look forward to it every Thursday. And until it came into being, I had really nothing to do and you just knit or sew or read or something.
I believe
like
you're
that.
A dab hand with the crafts.
I don't know about that.
And in fact, that you were involved with some of the crafts that we saw today.
Yes, a little of it.
Mm, quite yes. Fair play to you. And you're also one of the fundraisers for the swimming pool.
That's right, yes.
I know a comic yes. called Sean Connors who claims when they came round collecting for the swimming pool, he gave him a bucket of water. Is the swimming pool
I
built?
I think of that. Pardon?
Is the swimming
oh,
pool...
it's on the go for the past 20. Is it 20?
And what are you still raising money for?
20 years. Well, of course, it needs a lot of repairs and painting and all the rest, you know.
Good. Yeah. So the club and one thing and another keeps you busy.
We run socials for it, you know, and do a bit of catering and that.
Well, you're a lively soul. Like, I'd say you'd still cut a rug, would you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that'd be a bit of a dance, yeah. Love an old social.
Would Paddy Maloney ever ask you up?
Paddy has his own for asking up. But ask me up here.
Where's Paddy?
Paddy's there beside
you. That's Paddy,
him.
Is it? Yeah. Because, well, the reason I did a double take here, because it says here, Paddy, do you mind me mentioning your age?
I'm 81.
81?
Yeah.
That's hard to believe, sir.
Well,
it is
I am.
Indeed.
You're a fitting and lithe 81, if you don't mind me saying so. And it says here, all your family are away, and you keep on the move.
Of course.
Now, what do you mean by keep on the move?
Well, I'm implicated with the Edenary Town Football Club.
Oh, the football.
Yeah. And I'm away every Sunday, out in Ratgar last Sunday morning.
Fair play.
And
did you play a bit yourself?
Years ago.
Were you any good?
No. I don't think so.
Listen, there was a soccer team in my hometown, which was Bangor, and there were no... There was a fella in a bar, and he had a dog with him. And the dog was sitting there going, oh! The fella walked in, he says, excuse me, he says, but what's that about the dog? He says, he always does that every time Bangor lose. And he says, what do you do when they win? He says, I don't know, I've only had it 2 years. What did you say you worked at?
I'm working since I was 11 year old.
11?
I worked in the shoe, or in the Edenbury furniture factory. Yeah,
the furniture?
Aylesbury's factory, before where the shoe factory is now.
Mm-hmm.
Worked about 11 years there. And then I was unemployed, and I went to work in the shoe factory. I worked 33 years there.
Somebody was telling me in the furniture factory they used to make, was it parts for, like, horse-drawn...
cars and buses, and they made everything there.
Really?
Tennis rackets, hockey sticks, what have you. They met everything there.
They did the whole lot?
Done the whole lot.
I'd say Edenbury was a queer busy place when that place was called.
Yeah, it was a good town. Mm. Good factory, then.
And I'm told then you worked in the cinema for a while.
I worked 6 years.
And what did you do?
I operated.
Were you a projectionist?
Yes. I up wonder what time when you was break down, what you was going to be doing, they clap their face.
When there's a breakdown here? Oh, when there's a breakdown here, the first thing they do is lock up the cocktail cupboard. That's the first thing that happens right away. The cocktail cupboard gets slammed shut.
Yeah, I worked there about 6 years. I practically worked at the first talk he ever came to the town.
Really? Can you remember what it was?
No, not really.
No?
That's just a long time ago.
No, Gay Byrne was probably in it. Yeah. But did you enjoy the old movies?
Yeah, I used to work. I had two jobs, you see.
Uh-huh.
I worked in a shoe factory and I worked in the...
In the cinema?
In the cinema.
Oh, so you did rightly.
My son and grandson is doing it now.
Very good. So you handed it on.
And one now, the Savoy Edenbury.
Still in the cinema, in the Savoy in Edenbury. You've turned it into a family business.
That guy you had there the other evening, or talking about here...
Who was that?
The comedian you were.
Oh, the comic? Oh, or Har Roach?
Har Roach.
Yeah.
He earned a few nights standing.
He did a few gigs there, did he? Well, it's always nice to hear about people doing a few gigs. Let me tell you about a group that are one of the most popular acts around the country. And these people have done more gigs and more one-night stands than most. They have a terrific new record out. They're going to sing it for us now. Will you welcome, please, especially for you, the Morrisseys.
Call our own. We'll find love in you. joys will never cease. Out there beneath the kindly sky, we'll go to sweet rest somewhere in the west, and let the rest of the world go by.
There they are, ladies and gentlemen, the Morrisseys. Hasn't she a fabulous voice? One of the nicest voices I know. Would anybody like a copy of that record? Like a copy of that record? Well, I tell you what, we have a copy of that record, courtesy of the Morrisseys, for every single one of you. Just a wee souvenir. Now, if you like making music yourself, stay tuned, because we've got something coming up that you're going to be very interested in. So join us in 1 minute for part two of Live at Three. I might add, and one that we want to keep as fresh for our studio audience as it is for you at home. Anne O'Dwyer has the details.
Yes, well, we're very, very lucky this week because we have with us Frank O'Neill, and he comes from Clonmore. That's near Edenderry, isn't
it,
Frank?
Yeah, 5 miles from Edenderry, yeah.
Yeah, and Frank is going to show us how to make a bowron. Well, that's certainly a very unusual talent, I would say.
Yes.
Have you been making them for a long time, Frank?
Well, I know how to make them for a long time, but I haven't made that many. I make them for the hobby thing.
So now that you're sort of semi-retired,
yeah,
you're doing
more time
them. Okay.
Now, yeah.
Mm. Well, let's get into it now. What's the very first thing you do?
Well, the first thing I do, I get to make a little frame, actually. The frame. I make the frame from 1/8 inch plywood. You want about 5.5 feet long and 4 inches deep. And you put it into hot water, as hot as possible. The bath is ideal.
Plywood.
The one at the house lets them meant to do it.
Yeah.
Yes. And wonderful, about 20 minutes or so.
And you just put it in the bath,
put hot water in. Yes, hot water, yes, yeah. And take it out of the hot water then. And if you have an old drum or something round,
that
you would pull it around, you know. Maneuver around very, very gently because you're very, very fragile and it's not very easy. So with patience anyway, time, you'll get it around. And you're about 6 inches of a lap in it.
Yeah.
And you tack it on there. No, you want two of them because the double, see, the double one. Two of them. That means you have your circle ready. Mm-hmm. Now you'll get...
that will take you quite a while, will it?
Oh, it would. Oh, if you're lucky, if you get 1 hour.
I see.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see. Well, that's hard enough work,
Yeah, well, you get your two bits of sticks, you know, one. That's the handle of a brush, actually, made that.
Yeah.
The handle of a brush.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
It's very handy. Square, okay,
yeah.
And that's...
And you take your dam. That's for to cinch in the frame.
Mm-hmm.
See, to keep the frame for, and also for holding when you're playing it.
Yeah.
But you take your...
Well, now, would you make your make this first, and then you'd measure...
Yes, it's very hard to make the exact diameter.
Yeah,
and then get the measurements and put in that.
Okay.
And there's a panel tack on each of them. The four of them.
That's your...
That's the frame.
That's your frame.
That's the frame.
Okay, well, now we go to the next thing. So what do you want now?
Well, now, this is the skin. This is the raw skin now. This is a skin, kind of. It's the flesh side of it is cured, as you can see.
Yes.
You get a fresh skin. It can be goat skin, deer skin, fox skin, calf skin.
You've made it out of all of them, have you?
Well, it is. The fox skin is rather free and rather fragile, but the calves and deer and goats are the best.
Well, this is a goat skin.
This belongs to a young goat now. And you get a fresh, you trim off all the with some of the legs, heads and tail, mm-hmm. and what that size, the size of your frame, and plus a few inches extra that you want for pulley. You get 42 ounces of saltpeter and the chemist and 2 ounces of alum. Mix them together.
Saltpeter and alum.
Saltpeter and alum. Yeah, yeah. 4 ounces to 2 ounces of each. Shake it all around the skin. Nice and even. And put the air bugs. Rub it in as hard as ever you can. Rub it in until it's as much of it as possible to soak into the skin.
Over the whole lot.
Over the whole lot. And you can put a roller over it and put it away for a day or two and have a look ahead again. And get a blunt instrument, a knife or a piece of broken glass, anything dull instrument, scrape off as much flesh as possible.
Yeah. So that's and will it be sort of hard at that stage?
No, the saltpeter and the alum will be seen very nice actually.
Oh, I see, grand.
Now you get lime, this is the gaffer here, the next item.
Yeah.
You get a scoopful of lime, a quarter stone of lime, and mix it up into the same as you would if you were whitewashing the wall.
Yeah.
In a bucket and you can pay it. Yeah. And splash it on that. Yeah. And then put it back into the whatever container you mix the lime in, you put the skin into it.
Yeah. And how long would you leave that?
About 10 or 12 days.
As long as that?
Yeah, but you want to give it a stir around once or twice a day because the lime will lodge on the bottom, you see?
I see.
Some people longer than you when they put the lime in it, they'll bury it in the ground, okay? So long as it's airtight.
Oh.
But after 10 or 12 days, if the hair doesn't come off, it really should come off, it will come off.
Yeah. It'll not put it back in again?
Yeah, put it back for another day or two and you're in business.
Okay.
But I have a skin here, I have a complete one here.
Yeah, so we need the frame now. Have a look at the skin first.
This is a goat skin. That was a goat skin, but as I said, it can be a deer skin or anything. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that's a skin, that's complete.
Now that's wet. What have you been soaking that in?
I soaked in water yesterday.
Just water.
I had that for a month or two. And you get hard. You feel hard, nearly as hard as that could be.
So how long would you leave it? How long would you soak it now in the water?
A couple of hours.
Okay, so now how do we put it on?
Now you get your frame, you see, and that's what this supports out.
Yeah.
You spread it like one like that over here.
Overlapping quite well.
Now, the old-fashioned doll, which was longer for repairing the shoes.
Exactly.
It's in there.
Goes your little tack.
Yeah.
Now, that's an ordinary little brass tack, isn't it?
That is sturdy, Just put in a couple on each side. Won't do them fully.
No.
No, straight across here.
The other side.
Opposite that there. And you pull it. Now, the pulling is the whole thing. Stretching is the secret of a good bow run.
Yeah.
Stretching it. You know, you pull it as much as you can.
As hard as you can. And you put it in, it's in over the support, isn't it?
Pardon?
You put it in over the support
at the
start.
That's for the start.
Well, anyway, you're going to have a leaflet for us and you're going to tell us all how we do this, aren't you?
Yes, there's a leaflet there. Anybody that wants to know if they get that line, I'll give me a ring.
Yeah, that's great. We'll organise that. Two on each side.
It's the same across here.
Same at the other side.
Same the other side. And just like that. Put the same in there, through there and through there. And then continue on. Continue on and put about an inch and a half apart. The same as that.
And that's finally done now. You won't want to tighten that again. Of course you won't, because once it's dried out.
When that's properly tightened, that's the one over there.
Okay.
That will dry out as hard as that.
Let's have a look at your.
You've got a day or two.
Yeah, well, now here you. This is your.
There,
okay, I'll take this over here.
That's my own.
Now, if we just stand that up now, we can see you've got. It's very tight.
It is, yeah.
Very hard.
Yeah,
and you've got all your little tacks going all the way around the top.
All the way around, yeah.
And then, how did you finish it off?
Well, you trim it,
and then you put your varnish on.
Put a brand new stain, just an oak stain.
And that's it.
That's all, yeah.
Okay.
Well, the stick is the next.
Fine. Now let's see how you do the stick.
The stick. We get a friendly piece of wood, Sally or birch or anything. Say piece of wood,
that's
six and a half, 7 inches
hard.
Long.
Hardwood.
And pair them with a penny, if you haven't laid.
And then you put a little hole in it, and you've got a little.
Some people put a bit of leather now, right from the twine, because when you're beating it, especially in a warm round.
Yeah.
But we need to get sweaty and
trying
to sleep.
And
help us to beat with both in here.
Well, just now, let's give us a tiny little tip of that here for a second. Just very light now. Okay. We're going to get to demonstration in a few minutes. But first of all, what about the drum there? You have a drum there now.
Oh, yes.
That is too different. That's rather unusual.
That's all right. Just the notes and lessons.
I made
something different. You know,
yeah.
That's a goat skin.
That's goat skin. Yeah. And what's the other one?
Deer skin.
Well, that is quite a difference. There is a quite a different
slight
sound.
I thought there's somebody out there, a young fellow.
Exactly, a young fellow. Like, now, don't bang it too hard.
It's too high, no.
You'll take our ears off. Lovely. Okay. Frank, that's lovely. Well, now, the only thing that's left for us now is for you to show us how it should be played. So perhaps you'd go over to Eta there, and yourself and herself could play as a reel or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay, well, over you go, and we'll see how this should really be done.
Right,
Frank, thank you very much. Thank you. Well, now, any of you out there who might have decided Bowron, that's just what I want to make, okay, write into us here at Craft, RTE, Donnybrook, Dublin 4. Okay, and you can put Frank's name on, but if you put Craft, we'll know what it is. So, okay, over now to Eta and Frank O'Neill, and let's hear a reel on that Bowron.
Lost the run of yourself altogether. £10 for somebody who says to cure cramps, turn your slippers upside down. And not even with your legs still in them. I mean, curing cramps. A tenner for that. That'll tell you how easy it is to get a tenner out of this programme. £10 thing. Where's Harmar?
Yeah.
Harmar. Don't mind me asking you how you got a name like Harmar. What is that word? It's Harmar, is it? Or Har?
Harmar.
Harmar.
Yeah.
People walk past you in the street and say, har, har, mar. What's the har bit? Where does that come from?
It's just a nickname.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Where'd you get that?
Well, everyone had nicknames years ago.
Really?
You gave me that one anyway.
Could have been worse. Ringsend, you know, in Dublin's a great place for nicknames.
Yeah.
There's a fella that lives down there, I know to this day, he's still known as Stab the Dab. That's his nickname.
Yeah.
When he would go fishing, Stab the Dab. Harmar. And you left school at 16. That was late enough, I suppose, in those days.
Well, it was that time, anyway.
And you worked on the farm?
Worked on the farm.
And yeah. Then what?
Then I went to Bournemouth. When I left the farm, I went to work at the bar business.
Harmar in
the bar. Yeah.
Right?
sold drink very cheap that time.
I wish I'd known you back in those days, I tell you.
I remember selling 2 pints of stout and 10 cigarettes for a half a crown at that time.
2 pints of stout and 10 fags for half a dollar?
That cost over nearly £4 now.
I'm sure it would. But of course, wages weren't the same. When you started working with Borden and Mona, what sort of money were you knocking down?
£6 a week.
£6 a week? Wasn't an awful lot of money.
No.
Yeah. And you were at that for 25 years?
Well, corns are going on, you see. Wages rise, you see.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Sure. What do you do now? What do you do with yourself now?
Retired now. Just a light.
Somebody told me that you're a great man for the racing.
Do a good bit of it, all right.
Aye. Well, I mean, you don't race yourself. I mean, is it horses or dogs?
Oh, the horses.
The horses?
Yeah.
Have you got a tip?
Not now, anyway. I'll send you one the next time I get one.
All right, well, you have it. You have a deal. Yeah. Where would you do your racing? Where would you go racing?
The Curra, Leopardstown, Phoenix Park, Best Park, nearly all over the country. You mean?
And like, would you put a couple of quid here and there, would you?
Well, I lost more than I won.
You gave a lot of money to sick horses. You didn't know they were sick when you backed them.
There were some sick ones I did back.
Did you ever make a good killing? Did you ever get a Yankee up or anything like that?
No, I never was very lucky at them.
But you just enjoy being...
Enjoyed them. I love going to them.
And what about what about this club? You never married, did you?
Oh, did I? I'm married,
yes. You are married? Yes. Oh, I beg your pardon. Is your wife still with you?
She's right in the back here.
Is she back?
Yeah, in the back, yeah.
Well, I was told that you carried on like a single man.
Someone must be telling you lies, Derek.
Oh, not for the first time. So, you enjoy the club?
Enjoy the club very well. I think it's very... Looking forward to it every Thursday going up to it.
Good.
And all the friends and all. Very good.
I have to tell you, Har, there's an outbreak of waving taking place in this audience. If you want a wave, have a wave now. Right? Have a wave, right? All right, you can wave away. You can say hello to everybody down there, because we're coming to Thelma and her wrap for the day. All right, that's it. So it's hello to everybody in Edenderry and Clonmore too, Frank, just as a by-the-by. Thank you for joining us. God bless you, Edenderry, for coming up. We enjoyed your company very much, and you hope we'll see you again up sometime. Thelma.
Here, here, Derek. The great audience altogether. Stay tuned, because Emmerdale Farm is coming next, but I must say a sincere thank you to our audience from Edenderry, to all our guests, and indeed to you as well for watching. We hope that you'll join us for a cup of tea at home by your own TV set tomorrow, when we have fashion and music and horror.
Yes.
As the big employer.
Yes.
A lot of people don't know exactly where Edenderry is now. How would you look? If you're given somebody directions from, let's say, from Dublin, how would they get to Edenderry?
Down to Maynooth, Kilcock, Enfield, wheel to your left out of Enfield, straight for Edenderry.
And away you go.
Away you go. Away you go.
Well, I know from personal experience that it's a grand town. And I know that that music always goes well in that town. And I know because we've reached that point in the programme where, with great pleasure, I introduce to sing for some of your requests, Miss Anne O'Dwyer.
To wish all of you a very, very happy Christmas, and thank you all for all those lovely letters and Christmas greetings that you've sent in. And it's awful, I can't include all of you, but I'll do my best and I'll get through as many as possible. My first request then.
All the streets were dark and bare, and for me no scarlet ribbons, scarlet ribbons, scarlet ribbons. Scarlet ribbons for her hair. If I live to be.
Absolutely lovely, Anne O'Dwyer. One of my favourite tunes there, Scarlet Ribbons. Anne O'Dwyer and Aoife Flynn on the piano. Have you noticed that the 1988 calendars are out already? We got this one just recently. It's from the Friends of the Elderly, people we've featured on the show who do absolutely wonderful work. And each month there's a different portrait of an elderly Edmund, whom we've also met on our show here. A vivid and moving account of Dublin life in the 1920s and 30s. And Laura joins us now. You're very welcome, Laura.
Well stocked up.
Well stocked and well stacked.
Tickets and coal.
Tell me this. What was a turf camp?
Pardon?
What was a turf camp?
A turf camp? Well, in the 40s, Bord Lamona took over the camps, took over the bogs. They developed the bogs in Edenderry, and they built, they were called camps, but they were actually little houses, and they called them camps. And at that stage then, we had the turf workers came from the west.
They were hostels?
They were called hostels, I suppose, mm-hmm. Yeah. And they came up from mostly the west. Families came and worked on the bog there, and they were catered for by the Bord Lamona. And they built offices as well. They had their office staff there. And, there were hundreds of them there. And it was a great time in Edenderry because the businesses thrived by...
Well, indeed, if there was so much work... In the town, the workers didn't have to come out from the town, they were actually bringing workers in.
Well, yes, we had the workers from the town as well, but there was so much, the bogs were developed around, all round, I suppose.
All right, but tell me a wee bit about yourself. Your husband was a journalist on the
Leinster Leader.
The Leinster Leader, distinguished paper.
Yeah.
And I say he wrote a few articles about those days.
He did wrote a lot of interesting articles. He's 12 years dead now, but he was about 35 years on the Leinster Leader. And, sensational maybe of the town was the burning town of the town hall. And big fire. That was around 1940. The 1940s, I was about 45, and that was big sensational write-up for him. And then O'Brien's was a business, big business place, the Universal Providing Stores, and that was also burned down. That was in 1955. I should know. My son
married
was born
to a journalist,
that day.
You see, these things get stuck in your mind.
Yes,
listen, you're sitting
yes.
beside a man there, Sonny Collins, who's the living, walking expert in everything that moves in the area, because he's been, I could hear him any time I ask a question, to 1946, 1953, I don't know. How did you get the interest in the locality, Sonny?
Well, I don't know. I always liked history in a mild way, you know, even when I was in school. I liked to take mental note of dates.
Right,
I don't know why.
A lot of people would be surprised to know that there was a harbour.
Also, that's good. So.
Yeah.
Well, that back in 1797, the then owner of the town was Lord Downshire. No, this was in 1797, before there were any houses or even a semblance of a town.
He owned the land.
Oh, he did. Yeah.
Right.
He inherited through intermarriage with the Blundells, who had inherited from the Colleys, going back, if you want to know. But anyway. It was Lord Downshire the second. He was from County Down. His name was Hill, see, and he was Hillsborough, you know, in County
sure,
Down.
Sure, sure, sure.
The Dublin, then, you see, with the title Lord Downshire. He foresaw what a thriving town this would be. This was only a green...
Sure, sure, sure.
See?
If.
With a hill on the eastern side. If there was a waterway cut that would join up with the main line of the Grand Canal, which was at that time flowing from Dublin right down to the Shannon, you see?
And it was like the railroad coming to the Wild West.
It was indeed.
Yeah.
And ours was the spur, if you like. See, the branch line. Now, this was, as I say, before there was anything like a town.
Mm-hmm.
So in 1797, he organised the cutting of it. It finished in 1802. It took 5 years. It cost £695, and he paid it. Himself.
£695?
£5.
That
yeah,
was it?
For a mile long, yes. And strange to say, of course, you see, there was an intersection then, and the Grand Canal Company had to build the bridge.
Is that still navigable? Could you still get a boat?
It is, oh, quite. Yeah. Well, it's used to the present day by pleasure boats. People coming from all, well, from Dublin and on the various towns along the way, they come down here, maybe
to
the Shannon.
The
pull into Eden Derry for the night.
Grand.
And then
I suppose they could buy a pair of jumping jacks when they were there.
Well, yes, yes, the jumping jacks, they made quite a name.
For the benefit of those people who don't know what jumping jacks are, tell me.
Well, they were a beautiful type of children's shoes. And the sole didn't have a heel as such. The sole ran back up and it narrowed as it approached the back of the foot and came up almost ankle high and was stitched to a nice upper. It was a very, very practical thing for
jumping, the jumping jack.
I don't know
hardly a child in the country didn't at some stage look for a pair of jumping jacks.
A pair of jumping jacks. Yeah.
Around
and
this time of the year,
Santa
Claus would have been bringing a lot of jumping
quite
jacks.
Quite so.
Yeah, for Christmas.
Yes. And that right in the middle of the bog, those were manufactured.
Advice. All right, listen, I'm going to take a little break because we have another one of our Christmas treats for you. Now, I know Anne has done some birthday requests. I just want to throw in a quick couple. There's a Mrs. Kelly and her wee girl works in the newsroom here. Mrs. Kelly is 80 this week. And we also had during the week, I don't know if you saw our Millennium programme, and the Artane Boys band were in, and so were the Dublin City Ramblers. Well, now, Phil in the Ramblers, his son plays in the Artane Boys band. And Phil's uncle in the north is 94 this week. So greetings to them, and what better way of saying greetings to anybody than in the company of Mr. Sonny Knowles.
Where there is sunshine, that's where you are. Where there is laughter, you can't be far. You in my dreams every night. Oh, how I long to hold you tight. I need you, I'll follow you, dear, from here to a star. Your lips are honey, but sweeter by by far. From now till forever, I'll keep dreaming of you and the sunshine of love. Where there is sunshine, oh, that's where you are. Where there is laughter, then you can't be far. You in my dreams every night. Oh, how I long to hold you tight. I need you, I'll follow you, dear, from here to a star. Your lips are honey, but sweeter by far.
Well played, Mr. Knowles, Miss Flynn. Now, if you like that, do you like that? Yeah. Well, have no fear, undaunted by that lackluster response. He's going to do another one in part two. Anyway, no, good song and well received. If you like that, actually, you might be interested to know that Sonny has a new LP out for Christmas called My Souvenirs. Yeah. And there's one to keep an eye out now for the stocking. You need a big stocking, mind you, but that's not here.
Last night,
lovely.
They didn't see me creep down the stairs to have a peep. They thought that I was tucked up in my bedroom fast asleep. And I saw Mommy tickle Santa Claus underneath his beard of snowy white. What a laugh there would have been if Daddy had only seen Mommy kissing Santa Claus laugh.
Do we have another shot at it? Come on.
I saw Mommy kissing Santa Claus underneath the mistletoe last night. They didn't see me creep down the stairs to have a peep. They thought that I was
lovely.
And I saw Mommy tickle Santa Claus underneath his beard of snowy white. What a laugh there would have been if Daddy had only seen Mommy kissing Santa Claus last night.
Well, thank you very much, Sonny. Absolutely lovely. That fellow, he can just about sing anything, can't he? Anyway, he's also troublesome because just before I came on, he said...
Well, you see, even teddy bears have their uses now, I'm telling you. Where is Lena Foran? That's you, Lena. Lovely to see you. You are another lassie raised in the bog. Well, you know, we were talking to Lara Redmond earlier on about Christmas and the Liberties and so on. Any Christmas memories growing up?
Well, there was a big crowd in our family.
But,
I was 17.
17?
Only.
Aye.
Oh, he had a good, happy family.
Aye.
We never had rows, not to talk about anyway. We always made it up. We hadn't that much room. There was 12 boys and 5 girls. They all worked on the bog.
And your father?
My father worked on the bog. He cut turf. My mother worked on the bog. My brothers, when they were able, all went to the bog.
Good heavens.
They all worked on the bog. They sold turf as a shilling a load. One, not a new shilling now, 1 shilling for a load of turf.
12 old pennies.
12 pennies.
5 new PI. For a whole load of turf.
For an ass load of turf.
An ass load.
A donkey's load of turf.
An ass load. Hello, would you send around an ass load of turf for going low?
For 1 shilling.
Aye, for 1 shilling. Aye.
And a horse load of turf, they got 5 shillings.
A horse load?
A horse load.
Right.
Beat horses. 5 pounds. Yeah.
Right. What about your father? Did he, was it the...
He cut the turf.
Aye, did he do any other work for Baia?
Well, he did a lot of ploughing for people, and anyone that wanted a day's work, he would have done it.
What sort of timetable did he have to work?
Well, he often got up at 5 o'clock in the morning and go to the bog, go out to plough, have that done again, yes, and come in and have his breakfast and go to the bog and work a day.
And produce 17 children. I tell you now.
He had nearly all produced at that time.
I suppose he needed something to do in his spare time right enough, isn't it? He must have been a mighty man. How did you celebrate Christmas together on the bog?
We all had a great time every Christmas. We all had full and plenty. We'd a big pit of potatoes in the garden, and we'd have maybe a big ham, and my mother had always put down the big pot. We had an open fire, and the pot had held about a stone and a half of potatoes. And she'd have ham, and she'd have everything.
And did your mother always make the wee bit extra, even apart from Christmas? She always made the wee bit more than she needed.
She always made a bit more because she always had somebody coming. She always thought, she said, I'd always have a bit for whoever comes in the door. And she always had.
Well, that was hospitality. And you've got, indeed, and many happy memories from it too. All right, nice talking to you. Now, Lil Sutton, Lil. Hiya, Lil, how are you? Lil, you were born in Road.
That's right.
Now, where is Road?
7 miles
from Eden. Down the road. No, 7 miles down the road.
From Eden Derry. You know Eden Derry, yeah.
Oh, I know Eden Derry, all right. Oh, I do.
Seven miles, the far side of Eden
Derry. On the far side.
Near the power station in Road.
Near the power station, right.
Just beside.
And tell me a wee bit about yourself. Were you born and raised in Road?
Yes, that's right.
And then I know you worked, did you work in Dublin for a while?
Yes, in the Masonic School.
What did you do?
The girls.
The girls' school. Yeah. I would suggest you were working.
I was an assistant cook there. Well, there was boys and girls, you know.
Oh, aye.
Boys was in Donnybrook.
And where did you meet the husband?
Back home in Road. I left home and went back home, yes.
Oh, aye. There was no mess and you weren't going to meet some
no,
city
no,
slicker.
No, no, no,
oh, no. No, 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 no. Was that marriage, well, I wouldn't say was it arranged, but did the families get together at all on it to get you sorted out? Or was
oh,
it
no,
just...
I sorted myself out. I was the only one that
did.
Yeah. Got married, 4 children. Aye. Now I have 16 grandchildren.
16 grandchildren?
My husband is dead since 1972.
Aye. And what do you do with yourself now? Because you were very busy with the catering of the family.
I was, that's right. I went to work in the local hospital after my husband died.
Aye.
And I was done night work there for 13 years.
Oh, I suppose.
So I'm retired 2 years.
All right, listen, I know that there are some pals of yours. There's 2 ladies over there. Is it May and Jenny? Is that right?
Yes.
May and Jenny lying low there, right? Yeah. Now, I'm told you're great at the crafts, right? The crafts and the paintings and things. Now, we have a few bits and pieces attached to our wall at the moment. Mm-hmm. I'm most curious to know, there's a picture behind me which is a sort of, it's like a Lowry print. Right? And if you just, can we have a look at that? Look at that, isn't that splendid? Mm-hmm. Now, you may think that that is painted and it has a great sense of depth and texture to it. Well, I'll tell you, in fact, that is a tapestry.
It's a copy of a Lowry painting.
Mm-hmm.
And it's done in tapestry. Lowry was a North of England modern painter. He died in 1976, at about the age of 80. And all his paintings were done of Northern England scenes, industrial.
Well, did you do that tapestry?
Yes.
That's your work? Fair play, you have a great gift. Now let's have a look. There's another one there too, the ruin. There's, I'm not referring to Sonny now.
That's Carol.
There's a ruin. Now, again, that has great depth to it. That's actually a craft that we're familiar with on this programme, because that's actually collage, isn't it?
No, it's not. It's tweed.
Oh,
tweed
so he put this place right. It's not. It's tweed.
Tweed.
A tweed.
Yeah, it's a copy of Carberry Castle. It's a castle about on a hill about 2 miles from Edenderry in County Kildare.
Really?
It was the castle of the De Birminghams from the 12th century on.
Right. Let's just have a very quick look. There's some little dolls set up on a table over there. I don't know if you can see them down there.
You want to turn one upside down?
Oh, I wouldn't turn it. We turn a doll upside down. Good heavens, woman. I mean, what kind of a man do you think I am? But as I say, it's part of the lovely craft work which is done by you and your friends. And fair play to Edenderry. You wouldn't believe it, but the time is actually gone. And my apologies to those I know, to those people I wanted to talk to and didn't. But you see the nice thing about this programme? There's always a next time. All right, Edenderry, thank you. God bless you.
Well, thanks to all our guests and to our lovely audience. But do try and watch Live at 3 this week. It's our last week before Christmas and we're making it a special one. Tomorrow, our guests include Garda singers Michael Lang and John Roach, country singers Frankie McBride and Gloria, and ballad singer Paddy Riley. Our features include a glittering fashion item, we'll have some gift suggestions from motorists, we look at a special kind of Christmas decoration, we've horoscopes, a feature on children's books, and more besides. Live at 3 is always special. This week, it's extra special. See you tomorrow.